Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Candy House, written by Jennifer Egan and read by a full cast.
The brain is wider than the sky, for put them side by side, the one the other will contain with ease, and you beside. Emily Dickinson. For nothing is more unbearable, once one has it, than freedom. James Baldwin, Giovanni's Room. Build.
The Affinity Charm. 1. I have this craving, Bix said as he stood beside the bed, stretching out his shoulders and spine, a nightly ritual before lying down. Just to talk. Lizzie met his eyes over the dark curls of Gregory, their youngest, who was suckling at her breast.
Listening, she murmured. It's...
He took a long breath.
I don't know. Hard.
Lizzie sat up, and Bix saw that he'd alarmed her. Gregory, dislodged, squawked,
Mama, I can't reach.
He had just turned 3.
We've got to wean this kid, Bix muttered.
No. Gregory objected sharply with a reproving glance at Bix.
I don't want to.
Lizzie succumbed to Gregory's tugs and lay back down. Bix wondered if this last of their 4 children might, with his wife's complicity, prolong his infancy into adulthood. He stretched out beside the 2 of them and peered anxiously into her eyes.
What's wrong, love? Lizzie whispered.
Nothing. He lied, because the trouble was too pervasive, too amorphous to explain. He chased it with a truth. I keep thinking about East 7th Street, those conversations.
Again? She said softly.
Again.
But why?
Bix didn't know why, especially since he'd only half listened back on East 7th Street as Lizzie and her friends called out to one another through a cumulus of pot smoke like disoriented hikers in a foggy valley.
How is love different from lust? Does evil exist?
Bix was halfway through his PhD by the time Lizzie moved in with him, and he'd already had those conversations in high school and his first couple of years at Penn. His present nostalgia was for what he'd felt overhearing Lizzie and her friends from his perch before his Spark Station computer linked by a modem to the Viola World Wide Web, a secret, ecstatic knowledge that the world these undergrads were so busy defining, in 1992, would soon be obsolete. Gregory nursed. Lizzie drowsed.
Can we? Bix pressed. Have a conversation like that? Now?
She looked drained, was being drained before his eyes. Bix knew she would rise at 6 to deal with the kids while he meditated and then began his calls to Asia. He felt a wave of desperation. Whom could he talk with in that casual, wide-open, student-y way that people talked in college? Anyone working at Mandala would try, in some sense, to please him. Anyone not at Mandala would presume an agenda, possibly a test whose reward would be employment at Mandala. His parents, sisters, he'd never talk to them that way, much as he loved them. When Lizzie and Gregory were fully asleep, Bix carried his son down the hall to his toddler bed. He decided to get dressed again and go outside. It was after 11,
It violated his board's security requirements for him to walk New York streets alone at any hour, much less after dark. So he avoided the trademark deconstructed zoot suit he'd just taken off, inspired by the ska bands he'd loved in high school, and the small leather fedora he'd worn since leaving NYU 15 years ago to assuage the weird exposure he'd felt after cutting off his dreads. He unearthed from his closet a camouflage army jacket and a pair of scuffed boots and entered the Chelsea night bareheaded, bridling at the cold breeze on his scalp, now bald at the crown, it was true. He was about to wave at the camera for the guards to let him back in so he could grab the hat when he noticed a street vendor on the corner of 7th Avenue. He walked down 21st Street to the stall and tried on a black wool beanie, checking his look in a small round mirror affixed to the side of the stall. He appeared utterly ordinary in the beanie, even to himself. The vendor accepted his $5 bill as he would have anyone's, and the transaction flooded Bix's heart with impish delight. He'd come to expect recognition wherever he went. Anonymity felt new. It was early October, a razor of cold in the breeze. Bix walked uptown on 7th Avenue, intending to turn around after a few blocks, but walking in the dark felt good. It returned him to the East 7th Street years, those occasional nights early on when Lizzie's parents visited from San Antonio. They believed she was sharing the apartment with her friend Sasha, also an NYU sophomore, a ruse Sasha corroborated by doing laundry in the bathroom the day Lizzie's parents came to see the apartment at the start of fall semester. Lizzie had been raised in a world oblivious to black people, except those who served and caddied at her parents' country club. So frightened was she of their presumptive horror at her living with a black boyfriend that Bix was banished from their bed during her parents' first visit, even though they stayed in a midtown hotel. It didn't matter. They would just know. So Bix had walked, occasionally collapsing in the engineering lab under the guise of pulling an all-nighter. The walks had left a body memory, a dogged imperative to keep going despite his resentment and exhaustion. It sickened him to think he'd put up with it. Although he felt it justified on some cosmic balance sheet, the fact that Lizzie now managed every facet of their domestic lives so that he could work and travel as he pleased. The legion of good things that had come to him since could be seen as recompense for those walks. Still, why? Was the sex really that good? Well, yes. Was his self-esteem so low that he'd indulged his white girlfriend's magical thinking without protest? Had he enjoyed being her illicit secret? None of that. What had fueled Bix's indulgence, his endurance, was the thrall of his vision, which burned with hypnotic clarity on those nights of slogging exile. Lizzie and her friends barely knew what the internet was in 1992, but Bix could feel the vibrations of an invisible web of connection forcing its way through the familiar world like cracks riddling a windshield. Life, as they knew it, would soon shatter and be swept away, at which point everyone would rise together into a new metaphysical sphere. Bix had imagined it like the Last Judgment paintings, whose reproductions he used to collect, but without hell. The opposite. Disembodied, he believed, black people would be delivered from the hatred that hemmed and stymied them in the physical world. At last, they could move and gather at will, without pressure from the likes of Lizzie's parents, those faceless Texans who opposed Bix without knowing he existed. The term social media wouldn't be coined to describe Mandela's business for almost a decade, but Bix had conceived of it long before he brought it to pass. He'd kept the utopian fantasy to himself, thank God. It looked comically naive from a 2010 perspective.
but the vision's basic architecture, both global and personal, had proved correct. Lizzie's parents attended, stiffly, their wedding in Tompkins Square Park in 1996, but no more stiffly than Bix's own parents, for whom proper nuptials did not include a mage, jugglers, or fast fiddling. When the kids started coming, everyone relaxed. Since Lizzie's father died last year, her mother had taken to calling him late at night when she knew Lizzie would be asleep to talk about the family. Would Richard, their oldest, like to learn to ride horses? Would the girls enjoy a Broadway musical? In person, his mother-in-law's Texas twang grated on Bix, but there was no denying the zing of satisfaction her same voice, disembodied at night, afforded him. Every word they exchanged through the ether was a reminder that he'd been right.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.